to look up the book of John, and we're going to go like chapter 15, 10 and 11. And let's tell you, it is a privilege to stand here before you. I do truly stand here with fear and trembling. Not fear because you guys are so scary. I mean, we're going to go out and we're going to stand before some devils. That's not fearful, guys. We have the Lord God Almighty. But yes. I do stand here with fear and trembling because I fear my God. And I'm talking to men of God. If I misspeak, it may be somebody's eternity. Gentlemen, I mean trembling. I'm not going to dare preach to the preachers because every one of you I know, I admire from the deepest of my heart. You have changed my life from afar, and most of you never even seen my face before. So I sincerely say thank you, and I want to praise my Lord.
Amen.
I want to read this verse to you, then I want to tell you a little bit how I got here. Verse 10. If you keep my commandments, says the Lord, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abode in his love. These things I have spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. What I want to ask you, where's the joy of your salvation?
Amen.
I want to touch on 5 points real quick as I'm telling you how I got here. Examine yourselves before you go out there tonight.
Yeah.
Amen.
And see if you really got the full joy of the salvation that we read about, that we preach about.
Right.
Amen.
I was not raised in a Christian home. As a matter of fact, I'm not sure I was even raised in what would be considered a true home.
Right.
I was born in the same small town I live in about 9:30 a.m. My father was in the military and he couldn't get leave to come home to see his new son. Firstborn. My mom. Made her mad.
Yeah.
So I was born. By 11:30, she had checked herself out. And this little man, we walked 2 blocks to the local bar. Within a week, I was seen laying on top of the car. The summer sun beating down, and God wasn't through with me, because in my bottle was my first drink at a week old.
Wow.
That continued on for years. Except without mom. At 18 months old, mom had enough of me. So she took me to a relative's house and said, here, you have him. Dad came along, thought he was going to help raise, but he saw gold in his eyes in them California hills. So 2 years old, he looked at this little boy, hanging on to the bed, not knowing his son understood. He was headed west, young man. Now Dad walks out. Let me tell you. The Bible promises when the world forsakes your father and mother, the Lord will take you up. This journey has been about bringing me to God. Wasn't raised in a Christian home.
Yeah.
I grew. And the grace was sufficient. I wasn't looking for this God that we preach about. Nope. I was happy in my sin, just like the people we're going to meet tonight.
That's right.
I didn't say I had joy. Remember, I'm asking you a question. Where's the joy of your salvation? I was happy in my sin. Street preacher came through my town. He started on one end of my little town, and he preached all the way till he got to the center of town. And I heard his loud voice When he got to the center of town, this sinner left his job and went to watch this man of God. He was the rudest man I've ever met in my life. Boy, did he know how to get the target to this sinner.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
But that wasn't my salvation. We've been talking a lot about women today. I'm standing in the midst of my debauchery. A little woman about this tall comes up. I don't think the top of her chin, the top of her head come under my chin. And she looked up at me. And she said, Larry, I know you think you're a good person. But you just told us, why don't you Christians leave us, please? Leave me alone. Larry, when God forgets your name, when God forgets your address, then you got a real problem.
Yeah.
It's not because the street preacher made his way through town and you thought he was rude. It's not because the Christians keep coming knocking at your door. It's not because somebody shoved a tract in your face or a Bible down your throat. You got a real problem when God forgets you.
Yeah.
Now we're together, yeah.
That little woman got my attention. Not many nights thereafter, the Lord who died for sinners like you and I, the Lord who was buried to take those sins away, the Lord who rose from graveyard dead, he came looking for me because I wasn't looking for him. Then he brought me a wonderful woman of God. We went on our honeymoon. Brother Reuben talked about the potter's house. We really went to the potter's house. Up in Mance country. Up in Missouri and Arkansas. There is the potter's house.
Right.
So for our honeymoon, this young, saved, brand new believer, we went to the potter's house. We climbed to the top of this mountain where there's this large, I can't even tell you how big it is, idolatrous cross. And on the way back down, the journey starts again. My young bride, she starts to hyperventilate. I'm a new husband, I don't know what to do. We're walking down this rocky cliff trying to get her back down. And God's got one more molding experience for this man. A van. Cargo van. Filled with four drunken druggies, see me struggling trying to get this new bride down. So off the road they come, down the side of the mountain. I'm thinking they're coming to hell. God's talking about molding a man. They swing the panel door open. They ask what's going on. And I make a horrible mistake. Gentlemen, I said, we're on our honeymoon. And my wife's hyperventilating. But when you got drunken, drugged up sinners and they hear honeymoon, they hear sex. Guys, they took us. They threw us. Well, let me grab this. They opened the front passenger door. They grabbed my wife. They threw her into between the two drivers there.
What?
They pinned her against the doghouse. They threw me to the back. And the van is rolling down the hill. And they're telling me exactly about what they're going to do to my brand new bride.
Oh my God.
In front of me.
Tell them.
One's got me pinned down in the back. As you can see, I'm not a really big man.
Yeah.
One's sitting in the middle.
Mm-mm.
And I don't know what to do.
No.
Mm-hmm. I see things happening. Mm. I remember this street preacher who made this sinner tremble. I'm at the back of the van. They're holding me down. And in my ignorance, I start preaching, echoing through this van with every ounce of blood I can make pump from my heart. And I start hearing threats. Boy, you're in Missouri. There's places in these hills that they could, we could leave y'all's body and nobody ever finds you.
Mm.
And I keep on preaching. Suddenly, the boy in the middle, with some background of Christianity somewhere, starts to sober up. And he says, you got to get these guys out of here. They still got my wife pinned up front. I'm rolling around in the back now, looking at my new bride, trying to figure out what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
All I knew is the preaching made me tremble. So I'm thinking, God, your word's powerful. We get to the bottom of the mountain. As far as I'm concerned, they convinced me I'm a dead man. Clearly, I'm standing here. That didn't happen. But they do swing the door open. They throw me out. I go rolling across the rocks. And I promise you, my faith is being tested. Just like it's going to be testing you guys tonight when you walk out there.
Amen.
My God is real. I crawl up as quick as I can. I grab onto the mirror of the van as they're driving off. And suddenly, I watch four drunk druggies break down. To this day, I can't tell you, except the God we serve broke them. They swing the door open. They shove my tearful wife into my arms.
Amen.
And they said, man, you crazy. Nobody's ever talked to us like that before.
Amen.
And they speed off and leave me and my wife standing there.
Thank you, Jesus.
And you tell me that's not a molding experience if you're a brand new believer and you haven't been raised in church. All you've heard is some street preacher and a little woman telling you you got problems when God forgets you. You tell me that won't mold your faith? Mm. Folks, this is the kind of folks we're going to be preaching to tonight. These are the kind of people that grow up in America. We have a third generation. I think it's a pink lady, pink haired lady on TV is what this is all about. We're going to preach about a Jesus who can save.
Amen.
It's Jesus who can change. Now, real quick, somebody give me a verse on, yeah, I don't care what verse, a verse on prayer. Just any verse that comes to your mind.
John 16:24.
And it says,
hitherto, if you ask anything in my name, ask that you might receive, that your joy might be full.
Come on. All right. Now give me a verse on praise. Anybody got a verse on praise?
The last psalm in the Bible, it's all about praise.
Psalm 150 or something. Yeah.
But everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Okay. 5 points real quick. I'll close. Joy of your salvation. Are you prayed up? As Brother Reuben says, if you're just now praying, you're going to be paying. You're too late. Have you been praising? Have you been praising before you even see the answer? Preparation. What are you preparing for? Well, I proclaim. Now, last one, Mark kind of touched on. Reuben has definitely touched on. If your joy is missing, you may not be prayed up. You may not be praising enough. You've probably been preparing, but for the wrong reasons. You ask not because you have not. I doubt in this room there's very few that haven't been preaching, but that will definitely steal the joy of your salvation. The last one is persecution. Persecution, guys, it's not coming, it's here. Now, I'm so humbled to be here because for a little over a decade now, I've been doing open-air ministry of some sort.
Praise God.
But the first time I came in contact with anything like this, I looked on the internet, and there was a guy named Dick in Atlanta, Sopa. And I called him. I said, let me tell you what just happened to me. I opened there, preached for the first time. Here's what happened, Dick. I'm standing by myself. A gentleman walks up to me, and I'm going, how you doing? I did not realize he's left-handed. This is my virgin time, open-air street preaching. And he sucker punched me here. And being the nice Christian that I am and talking to all the little old ladies in church, I said, how can I pray for you? And he sucker punched me again. Oh. Now, this time I was the sucker. Folks, this went on 9 times. Now, man, let me tell you, when somebody hits you, you don't want to say, how can I pray for you? Yeah. You want to take them all the way to the ground. But the Lord had a different opportunity there. Wow. By the time this was through, there was traffic stopped in the streets. There were people crawling out of the cars wanting to know what was happening. I'm bleeding here. It turns out he busted all this socket around here. Mm. And for months, people I've never seen in my life come up and wanted to talk about Jesus. Man. 9 times. Stitches, broken bones, my virgin preaching. I called up Dick. He says, "Welcome to the club." He said, "What you need to do is you need to meet some man named Reuben Israel." I said, "Okay." And he told me about him. I think, this is great. But chances are, Oklahoma's a long ways from California. So, how I got here, I found myself at the Super Bowl in Irving, Texas. I'm walking around, giving out tracts, talking to people one-on-one, and I look up, and here's a group of men with banners and bullhorns.
Truth Horns.
And I'm watching the effectiveness of this. And I walk over, and I'm thinking, Lord, this has got to be the most effective thing I've ever seen. I'm watching beer bottles of every sort, shape, and size, from little kids to old men and old women, flying at these men. I'm watching these bottles fall short of hitting these preachers. I'm even watching people walk up like you see in the scriptures, and they bow down before these preachers like they're almost having to genuflect before some good Catholic idol, and they're cursing them, but the same token, gentlemen, you know what I'm talking about. I can't even explain to you. The book of Acts suddenly become alive. Amen. And I walk over and shake this man's hand, who turns out to be this Reuben Israel. Unlike what he said this morning, in the old days, some of the guys didn't have 8 minutes for an 18-year-old. I hope each one of you appreciate him, because he's taking time to not only put this together, but to bring us together to learn from each other.
Yeah.
He's taking time to explain behind the scenes what goes on. He's taking time to help us to grow the joy of our salvation. So what's missing in your life? Prayer? Praise? Preparation? Preaching? Are you avoiding persecution? I said I'm not going to dare preach to the preachers. I can tell you war story after war story, and I'm sure you could share with me, and we would really enjoy. Like the brother said when I walked up, I didn't know what to do. All I knew, I had blood running down my face the very first time. I had broken bones and didn't know it. And I went to somebody, the only somebody I knew, and he still gives me a hard time to this day. He said I had the goofiest grin of any white boy he's ever seen. He said, look what the Lord gave me. Persecution, brother. It's joy. Whether it be just a black eye, or whether it be your wife on your honeymoon, proving to you that Jesus Christ is alive. When the devil comes knocking at your door, send Jesus. Amen. Let's go knock at the devil's door tonight.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Let's set some souls free.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Mm-hmm.